The morning sun shines on the gleaming hide of a muscular ranch horse. The aroma of bacon and coffee drifts from the wood cook stove at a cow camp. Silver spurs jingle as the men and women of the West get set for another day in the saddle. From the heart of Canada's finest ranching country, this is the Spirit of the West with rancher and horse trainer Hugh McLennan and his collection of music, poetry, and conversations with the folks who live and work with horses and cattle in the Spirit of the West.
There's a legendary ranching and rodeo cowboy that I always intended to have as a guest on this show, but it didn't get done and we lost him a few years ago. He mentored a host of young rodeo cowboys, provided some of the best bucking stock to ever enter a bucking chute. He was chief of the local Indian band for many years, and he was a great historian, stockman, and storyteller. His name was Gus Gottfriedson. Well, today, Gary Gottfriedson, one of Gus's boys, is my guest. Now, Gary is an author, an educator, a horseman, and we'll look at everything from the subject of his doctorate degree that he'll be working on at UCLA to his early memories of the big horse roundups he and his brothers and his dad used to do.
The only way we could get away from him is we'd just lay right down on the saddle, right on the neck.
And digging down into the vault this week, we'll come up with a scary story about a flat-out runaway from Miles Kingdon.
We got up to the top of the hill, and he went back down that hill and hit that horse of my partner's right in the shoulder, just about ironed him right out.
The Rangeland News looks at the connection between rising interest rates and food price inflation.
If we have an increasing energy costs, we will expect increases in food prices.
And this week, something pretty special. We will offer a pair of weekend passes to the Stony Plain Cowboy Gathering to someone who gets the right answer to the question I'm going to ask in just a little while. It's kind of a Western history question, so don't miss that. The Horse Training File looks at this question. You want to have an argument with your horse or a conversation? And the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight is pretty special, too. A young cowboy and singer has a tribute to his dad, someone a lot of you will remember. And the music list is some of those special songs that'll stay with you all week. And we start off with Steve, Leslie, and Steve. That's two Steves and Leslie. She's a girl. Together, they're the Old West Trio.
Out on the blue prairie, I'm a riding rope cowboy. I work out on the range. Cow punching is the life that I desire. A roping and a branding is how I make my wage. At night, we're drinking coffee around the fire. Got a gal that waits alone for this cowboy to come home. Every night I see her in my dreams. Cattle low and prickly pear, sage and coffee in the air. She's in my every thought, or so it seems. Out on the blue prairie, reminds me of the one I love. Out on the blue prairie, that sparkle in her eyes up in the evening stars above. Along the blue prairie, I'm melancholy blue as I can be. Where the blue fills the sky like the blue in her eyes. I'm blue, prairie blue. Them cattle down the trail, take them to the stockyard far away. I leave that little gal of mine behind to no avail. I think about her more and more each day. And everywhere I look, I find her silhouette up in the pine, scent of her perfume along the trail. Cactus bloom, prairie flower, tumbleweed in April shower, her whisper in the lonesome coyote's wail. Out on the blue prairie reminds me of the one I love out on the blue prairie. That sparkle in her eyes up in the evening stars above along the blue prairie. I'm melancholy blues I can be, where the blue fills the sky like the blue in her eyes. I'm blue, prairie blue, prairie blue. Along the blue.
Gary Gottfriedson grew up on horseback, but he also has an academic career. He's an author, educator, and Gary, your first book, Whiskey Bullets, had an interesting title.
The Whiskey Bullets book was looking at this whole duality about being a, you know, a native cowboy and fitting into the cowboy world, which, you know, people stereotype as not being native. So I thought, well, you know what, I'm going to show the world that it's one and the same thing. So I wrote a book based on that. And it really did well. It really did well. It actually got nominated for a national award.
And that takes us to what's coming up in the very immediate future for you as well. Now, you have a master's degree in fine arts, mm-hmm. and a master's degree in
education,
and you're going to be working on your doctorate at UCLA, mm-hmm. and that's going to be on, what did you say that was?
It's the first course is
biocolonialism.
That's right, it's biocolonialism, and it's a look at this modern approach that governments have at looking at indigenous peoples from different country and developing policies of how they're going to relate and govern these people. So it's really a political science, or, you know, like a legal kind of a perspective, I guess.
What would some of the countries be that this discipline would apply to, besides Canada?
New Zealand is a part of this policymaking and decision-making process from the government levels. Australia, Taiwan, Japan, even. A lot of countries where there were considered indigenous peoples or the first peoples of that country. My interest area is looking at, like, this whole aspect of partnerships. Because I grew up in a family, for example, where yes, we did have government policies that were very strong and that affected my family and people within my community. But I was fortunate enough to grow up in a family where we had access to many other peoples outside of our community. My dad worked, you know, like for a lot of the ranchers. My mom was actively involved in many different organizations and committees and that sort of thing outside of our community. So I grew up in this kind of environment, and my interest is looking at more, not as a dissection of country versus nations within the country, but looking more at, well, okay, if this is the reality of our nation at this point, then how do we bridge a partnership?
And coming right up, Gary Gottfriedson has some special memories of his dad when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. Gus Gottfriedson was born August 21st, 1913. He was a born horseman and excelled as a rodeo cowboy, stock contractor, and a rancher. At one time, Gus owned as many as 480 head of horses. He supplied rodeo stock for every level of rodeo, from little britches to pro. He was the Canadian wild horse racing champion in 1945, and during World War II, he broke horses for the Canadian Army. He retired from bronc riding in 1957. Some of his horses were national finalist ones, and some were used in Walt Disney film productions. And one of his boys, Gary, is here today. Gary, tell me some of the things you remember about your dad.
Oh, my dad was a gem of all the gems there. I mean, he was the type of man that, you know, Hugh, if you'd met him and, you know, you sat down with him, it's like he treated people like that he'd known them their whole entire life. And I mean, he was a really kind man, a really, really good man. And yeah, I have some great memories of my dad. You know, like he was a stock contractor, of course, and a rancher. And like you said, he was a cowboy too, a rodeo cowboy as well as a ranch cowboy. But some of my fondest memories go back with the horse roundups and the brandings and that type of thing. When we would be, you know, in the springtime, he's getting ready to bring all the horses off the range there along Skidam Flats down to the valley and getting his stock sorted out of where he's going to send, you know, what horse is going to go into Bronc section or the bareback section or whatever. You know, I remember, riding with my dad up there and all my brothers. I had seven brothers, you know, and they were all cowboys. But we would all ride together. Our neighbor over here, you know, like Vic Piva and his family used to work with our family. And there were different old-timers like old Roy Hines and people like that that used to all gather and, you know, help each other out there. And
oh, there are some big roundups on Skidam Flats.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, there's stories and stories.
That's how I started riding, actually.
How old would you have been when you first went along?
The very first roundup I went on, riding by myself, I was around 8, 9 years old.
Wow.
Yeah. I had to ride with my dad, and I had to ride with one of my older brothers. And so we were the flankmen. So I had to ride in between them, and they had to kind of watch me.
I've been on more cattle drives and roundups than I can count.
Yep.
And I've been on a few horse roundups.
Mm-hmm.
But that's a different game. Gathering horses is so much different, isn't it?
Thrill of it. I mean, you know, like you can just hear those horses thundering down the mountain when you start to gather them up. I remember one time when we went up into this little opening right up on top, right behind Mount Peter there. There's a nice big opening up there where there's some springs. My dad said, all right, you guys, we're going to stake them out, and this is where you guys bring them down. There's a trail that comes down through this way, and when they hit that trail, you know, you got to move into position and stuff. And I remember hearing those horses come thundering down the mountainside, you know, and just hundreds of horses coming down there. And you could hear those, you know, cowboys just hooping and hollering down in the valley when they hit Skidam Flats, and, you know, they'd make a big funnel, you know, and horses would, you know, the people would funnel them right into the corrals down there.
Amazing.
That's where we start riding.
Well, we'll get to some more of those adventures, but first, this all kind of reminds me of a song about wild horses that Fred Doberstein wrote.
West of the Rough Creek Timberland, on a wild land grazing lease, we left our bears to raise their foals where the wind blows through the trees. We returned, the mares were gone where we do not know. They were running with the wild ones along the eastern snows. We rode the hidden canyon on the mountainside so high. Rode across the blowdowns where the pine trees touch the sky. Through the muskegs and the swamp spruce, the tracks were plain to see. Dark shadows in the timber, running wild and free. Wild horses, shadows in the timber, all the rough, hiding on the rugged slopes of the North Saskatchewan. Stallion is the leader of the wild Mustang band, born to live a free life in that Rocky Mountain land. Wild slopes of the North Saskatchewan. Out there on the river breaks of the North Saskatchewan. Smoke from an old campfire brings back old memories, the time that we spent riding hard with the wind blows through the trees. We couldn't find the horses, the game we could not win, out there on the rugged banks of the North Saskatchewan. Wild horses, shadows in the timber on the run, found their tracks along the banks of the North Saskatchewan. A stallion is the leader of that wild Mustang band, born to live a free life in that Rocky Mountain land. Wild horses, shadows in the timber on the run, riding on the rugged slopes of the North Saskatchewan. Out there on the river breaks of the North Saskatchewan.
Okay, Gary, let's get back to some of those big horse roundups.
Is that the branding time and stuff like that? That my brothers would say, you know, like my brother Ronnie or Pee Wee or one of them, they would say, get on that colt. They'd strap us on this little
really?
Colt, and we'd be like up to 10, 11 years old. And we'd be riding those colts out there just, and they'd turn them out, and we'd be, they'd be bucking all over the hillsides. And used to have a few wrecks up there,
so
too.
You've been on more than one or two bucking horses in your life.
Yeah.
It's not a big deal. But you know, when you're gathering a big bunch of horses in big, big country, you got to be well-mounted yourself.
Oh, yeah.
And you don't want to be riding a colt doing that.
That's right. Oh, I remember my dad had this big old hunting horse. That was the horse that that trained us kids that were coming up for the roundups. This big old horse was named Brownie. I bet you old Vic remembers this horse. Yeah, that horse had to be at least 16 and a half hands high. And, you know, my brother, Bob, he wasn't too tall of a guy, but, you know, I remember him lifting me right up over his shoulders to get on the saddle. But that old pony was just as gentle as could be. And you just sit on him and he knew what to do. Mm. You just had to, you know, just rein him a little bit and he would move for you.
And when everything got pretty Western and all those broncs were on the run, he still was under control.
Still under control, yeah. Never ran away with you. You could just, you know, as soon as he felt you shifting or pulling up on him a little bit, my dad used to say, when you're ready, you holler the W word. But don't do it until
you want it.
Sure enough, one time, you know, I got a little bit too excited and that horse was running faster and faster. You know, the speed started to scare me a little bit. I don't know how old I was, maybe about 10 years old by then. And the speed was scaring me a little bit. And I hollered, whoa! And that old Brownie just come to a skid like that, and off I flew. And I had a heck of a time getting back up.
Way up there, yeah.
I grabbed onto the stirrup and put myself... climbed up onto his back again.
More from Gary Gottfriedson in a little while, and listen for the question. Answer it correctly and you could win a pair of weekend passes to the Stony Plain Cowboy Gathering August 12th to 14th, when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. How about the 2023 Friends of the Spirit of the West cruise? Well, it happens in January. You will visit 6 different countries, including the United States, Puerto Vallarta, Mexico, Otalco, Mexico, San Juan, Nicaragua, Punta Arenas, Costa Rica, Panama City, Cartagena, Colombia, as well as back to Fort Lauderdale. a 15-day cruise on the Emerald Princess, leaving Los Angeles, and a two-day Panama Canal experience. Special group farm tour in Costa Rica, and your hosts will be the official Spirit of the West support crew, Mark and Kathy McMillan. And you will be amazed, I think, when you see how low the prices are for this one. So just go to our cruise page at hugh-mcclellan.com or see the cruise Facebook page to find out more. And you can always call the toll-free number, 1-800-530-0131. Did I mention that this one will have everyone flying to Los Angeles on January 16th, 2023? And of course, airfare and hotels are included. And get this, everyone who books this Panama Canal cruise before July 31st, 2022 will get double their regular shipboard credits as returning guests. That could amount to hundreds of dollars for frequent cruisers and a big kickstart for first-timers. And that number again, 1-800-530-0131. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West.
Stories from the vault, from the Spirit of the West. This is where we dig deep for some of the most amazing stories from the folks who bring some heartwarming, knee-slapping, spellbinding episodes.
It's a great rush, being on a good horse with lots of speed and just letting him run, knowing you can stop if you have to, but when you're on a colt, and you're in an out-of-control runaway, well, that's different. Miles Kingdon has been there and done that.
Oh, yeah, runaways are something that, you know, I don't think it matters how many clinics you take and who it is. A runaway is still a bad deal no matter what way you look at it, and some you can fix and some you can't. And really, the only way to fix them is to prevent it in the first place.
Yeah.
And, but I remember this one big old colt who's about 16 hands high, 3-year-old. And he got it in his head that the best place to run away was on the side of an open hill with the wind blowing. And of course, up on that open country, when the wind is blowing, you got a hillside, they're going to do it anyway, if they're going to do it any place. That's why I kind of like to ride them in the timber a little bit better when they're that kind of a horse, that way inclined. But I remember this horse, he ran away quite a few times that morning. And I was dropping cowboys off on the circle. It was branding time, we were gathering cows. And I kept this one cowboy with me. He was a really good hand. And he was mounted on a good horse too. And I kept him with me to the top end. We dropped cowboys all the way. We got up to the top end. This horse, I thought to myself, holy smokes, he might be all right, you know. I didn't really trust it, but I thought, you know, I might be over the hump. He's got a sweat on him now. And he wasn't hanging his ear down at me anymore. And I was turning him around lots and giving him things to do and giving him some circles and hitting a trail, letting him look at a trail. And this horse, we got to the top end of this hill. And he looked down that hill and the program changed in his mind, and I didn't know about it, and he went down this hill, flat out. Well, this buddy of mine got down there. We kind of got him turned, and he was about four strides. He was going as fast down this hill as he could go. Well, I got up to the top of the hill again. By this time, my buddy's still halfway down the hill, and he's not sure what my horse is going to do or what I'm going to do, and I guess I didn't have time to explain it. We got up to the top of the hill, and he went back down that hill and hit that horse of my partner's right in the shoulder, just about ironed him right out, and picked up his spur in my stirrup. So we're riding right beside each other, neck and neck, and he's trying to dig his spur up. He's just moving his foot a little bit at a time, trying to get his spur out of my stirrup, and he got it out. Neither one of us said a word. We were just doing what we could to stay in there, and he run away like that 6-7 times through the day. And he come up packing his leg at the end of the day. And my old boss, who I worked for a lot of years, he said, well, I guess we can always take him to the auction and sell him for a buggy horse.
The 30th Annual Stony Plain Cowboy Gathering happens August 12th to 14th at Emmanuel Lutheran Church, Stony Plain, Alberta. Storytelling, music, and poetry with stars like Tom Cole.
Let me sing you a picture of an Alberta sky.
Doris Daly.
The porch light's on, a fire crackles bright, maybe Ian's singing at the Longview Hall.
Stuart McDougall.
As long as there's a memory of him, the sun ain't going down on sundown swim.
And so many more. For tickets and information, call 780-718-5379 and see StonyPlainCowboyGathering.com.
That's how it goes.
Okay, now, here's how you can get a pair of weekend passes to this great event. If you can get the answer, the right answer to this question. The famous Sons of the Pioneers were founded in 1933 by three musicians. Bob Nolan, who was a Canadian, Tim Spencer, and who was the third one? If you can get that answer right, email your answer to this email address. Listen closely. Stony Plain Cowboy Gathering at gmail.com. That's StonyPlainCowboyGathering at gmail.com. And we'll announce the winners just as soon as we get some right answers. And just ahead of the Rangeland news, here's a great combination. Good song and a fine voice, Hank Kramer and Roy Robinson's Cowboy Song.
Pushing horns weren't easy, like the movie said it was. I don't recall no hotel rooms, dancing girls and such. You worked hot, tired and nasty, rode your pony's head too low. No, the nights we couldn't sleep, 'cause it was too damn cold. We sang Strawberry Roan, Little Joe. Like the time we crossed the river and the rains began to fall. The water was rising so damn fast, we thought it'd drown us all. We lost a lot of steers that day and four or five good mounts. But when all the boys rode into camp, we knew that's what counts. We sang Whippity-I-O, Amazing Grace. Oh, the night they broke behind us and they took us by surprise. I whistled out to Bonner, I saw the terror in his eyes. Well, he rode his horse for all he'd ride, I know he'd done his best. He crossed over Jordan, riding Dunear to his death. We sing, Ringing the Seas and the Rugged Cross. So when you see a cowboy, he ain't ragged by his choice. He never meant to bow them legs or put that gravel in his voice. He's just chasing down a dream he loves and the only life he knows. Wishing to hell that he'd been born 100 years ago. Still singing Strawberry Roan, Little Joe. Still singing Whippity-I-O, Amazing Grace. Still singing Strawberry Roan, Little Joe.
The Rangeland News from the Spirit of the West. A roundup of issues and events from the world of agriculture.
At the top of page one, it says the kind of price inflation we're experiencing now has affected just about everything we buy, even though this has been a pretty good summer for hay so far. The price still has to go up, thanks to the cost of fuel, machinery, parts, twine, and everything else. And now the question is, will rising interest rates have any effect on inflation, especially in food prices?
Well, Gary Crawford standing by with another expert.
Grocery shoppers are seeing the highest rate of food price inflation since 1979 or so, with grocery store foods averaging 12% higher than this time last year. USDA economist Matt McLaughlin says there could be at least some light at the end of this food inflation tunnel in the form of interest rate hikes already announced by the Federal Reserve and hikes to come. McLaughlin says higher interest rates reduce the money supply and reduce demand, and so
we would expect that interest rates would bring prices down,
or at least slow those price increases down. However, he says one factor that puts upward price pressure on almost every food is rising energy prices. They're already running up to 60% higher than a year ago. And so
when we see increases in energy prices, even if we do have decreases in overall money supply, maybe some of these other costs are coming down. If we have an increasing energy costs, we will expect increases in food prices.
But he does not expect to see next month the kind of price hikes we saw this past month. Gary Crawford for the U.S. Department of Agriculture.
Well, new research into chronic wasting disease has found it may be so endemic in the environment that it could pose a threat to other species. University of Alberta professor Debbie McKenzie conducted some research into whether there is a possibility of CWD infecting beavers whose habitat often overlaps with that of deer. And what it is a prion disease in deer, moose, and elk that has spread widely across North America since it was first detected in the 1960s and is similar to BSE in cattle and scrapie in sheep. The prions are a type of protein that can trigger abnormalities in the brains and nervous systems of animals, resulting in neurological degeneration and eventual death. And unlike BSE, CWD is transmitted through saliva, urine, and feces. And she says the risks of direct infection of CWD to cattle in the natural world are unlikely, but if you passage through to another species, then perhaps we're going to have to change the barrier. The Canadian Cattle Association has a new general manager. Ryder Lee starts his new position on the 1st of September. Ryder previously worked for the Canadian Cattle Association in the Government Affairs Office in Ottawa from November 2005 to 2015, and he served as the Chief Executive Officer for the Saskatchewan Cattlemen's Association from 2015 to 22. And Executive Vice President Dennis Laycraft said Ryder brings an exceptional range of expertise with a strong industry background, years of work in agricultural policy, and advanced management experience. And they're looking for a new CEO for the Saskatchewan Cattle Producers Association. The job posting for that is at saskjobs.ca. Ryder grew up on a ranch in southern Saskatchewan that was managed today by his brother, who keeps Ryder up to date on what's going on. Well, the provincial government in BC is providing $1 million to the Small Scale Meat Producers Association for construction of a government-inspected licensed facility in Merritt, British Columbia. The abattoir will provide meat processing and cut-and-wrap services to local farmers and ranchers. And the new facility will keep local farms from folding, according to Julia Smith, the executive director of the Small Scale Meat Producers Association, and she's a beef and pork producer from Merritt. The new abattoir will process about 20 animals a week, including beef, pork, and game, and that means local ranchers may not have to rely on the larger processors further away. Well, as you may have heard, Billy and I were not able to host the cruise to Alaska that celebrated 30 years of the Spirit of the West. We had applied to renew our passports in early May, and they still haven't arrived, even though we have paid for them. Well, maybe we should have done it this way. Driving from Nebraska to Alaska isn't a quick trip, but for Dick and Carolee Oruda, the trip will take about 60 days, and that's because they are making the 3,910-mile trip in a 1977 International tractor as a way to raise money for kids. Yeah, maybe we could have done it on my old Ford 8N. Well, the next regular cattle sale at the BC Livestock Kamloops Yards is August the 9th, and a regular cattle sale at Williams Lake August 11th, regular sale in Vanderhoof August 12th. Get the details. See the sale streaming live at bclivestock.bc.ca. Meanwhile, at the Innisfail Auction Market, regular cattle sales, of course, every Wednesday. They start at 9 in the morning with butcher cows, followed by the other classes of cattle, and you can get the details or consign your yearlings or calves by calling this number, 1-800-710-3166. 1-800-710-3166.
Now, the final item, cowboy logic in the air. You see, a couple of guys who'd been at a remote cow camp all summer were heading for the National Finals Rodeo, and this was the first time either one of them had ever been on a plane, and it was a big 767. Well, it took about 2 hours. They were into the flight, and then the captain comes on the intercom and says, "Folks, we have lost an engine. But everything's okay. We've still got three more, but it will take us a little longer to reach our destination." And about a half an hour later, he comes on again and he says, "Well, folks, it seems we've lost another engine, but it's still okay. It's just going to take us another half hour to get to our destination." And one of the guys says, "Man, if we lose those last two engines, we'll be up here all day." Cowboy logic, and that's the Rangeland News.
Coming right up on the Urban Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File, would you rather have an argument or a conversation with your horse? And more memories from Gary Gottfriedson when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. Now, would you rather have an argument or a conversation with your horse? That's the subject of the Urban Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File coming right up. How about the 2023 Friends of the Spirit of the West cruise? Well, it happens in January. You will visit six different countries, including the United States, Puerto Vallarta, Mexico, Potalco, Mexico, San Juan, Nicaragua, Pontoneras, Costa Rica, Panama City, Cartagena, Colombia, as well as back to Fort Lauderdale. A 15-day cruise on the Emerald Princess, leaving Los Angeles, and a two-day Panama Canal experience. Special group farm tour in Costa Rica, and your hosts will be the official Spirit of the West support crew, Mark and Kathy McMillan. And you will be amazed, I think, when you see how low the prices are for this one. So just go to our cruise page at q-mcclellan.com or see the cruise Facebook page to find out more. And you can always call the toll-free number, 1-800-530-0131. Did I mention that this one will have everyone flying to Los Angeles on January 16th, 2023? And of course, airfare and hotels are included. And get this, everyone who books this Panama Canal cruise before July 31st, 2022 will get double their regular shipboard credits as returning guests. That could amount to hundreds of dollars for frequent cruisers and a big kickstart for first-timers. And that number again, 1-800-530-0131.
Now it's time for the Horse Training File, brought to you by Irvine Tack and Western Wear, Canada's largest Western store.
Here at Irvine Tack and Western Wear, they get it. You're busy. Between work, family, chores, finding time for shopping can be a challenge, right? Solution? Irvine's online. Buy now and take advantage of free shipping on orders over $100. Some conditions apply. Western Wear, with a welcome twist at your fingertips. Visit irvines.ca or stop in today, exit 305 off Highway 2 by Crossfield.
Canada's largest Western store.
Are you going to have an argument or a polite conversation? Well, Fred tried out a horse the other day. He didn't know much about this 8-year-old gelding, but he was supposed to be broke. He hauled him home, saddled him up, and rode him around the yard for a while, and then he took him out to the pasture. And the horse seemed to go pretty well until he came to a tricky spot on the trail where a little creek ran across. The horse stopped and refused to cross the creek. And I guess the old-timers and baseball umpires would call out a balk. Fred was an impatient guy, and he jabbed his spurs into the horse's ribs, and the horse reared up, whirled around, and pitched Fred off in the creek. Now, Fred was mad, and the horse was scared first, then mad. Well, Fred was ignorant and impolite to that horse. That horse didn't know him, didn't trust him, and if he could have had a conversation instead of an argument with him, things might have turned out differently.
Now, there are a number of tolerant horses that'll test a rider's resolve a little bit and respond to an aggressive approach, but there are many others, especially, it seems, athletic, well-bred horses that will meet force with force. And for this kind of horse, trust has got to be there first. As the trust builds over a period of weeks of regular riding, when the horse is concerned about going into a challenging or tricky spot, he'll be expressing his concern with his body language, his head will elevate, and you'll feel the tension through his body, and he's basically saying, "This is scaring me, boss," and your job is to reassure him that you are his leader, and you won't put him in danger. You politely communicate that you're in control, and it's okay to go ahead. And if he still doesn't have enough trust to go through the obstacle, then do something to take his mind off of what's scaring him, even backing him directly away from it. Maybe approaching, stopping, and backing and approaching a few times will work with some horses. The thing is, there are situations that can build long-lasting resistance if you handle it wrong, but if you handle it right, it'll build that trust you need.
And for Urban Saddles and Western Wear, that's the horse training file. Boy, our horses are doing well, even though they're getting up in age, and we attribute a lot of that to their daily feeding of Hoffman's Horse Ration. And you can find out all about it at hoffmanshorseproducts.com. From a radiator cap to an engine block, bctractorparts.com is your source for whatever you need to keep that essential implement in top shape. Specializing in quality new replacement parts for agricultural tractors, Massey Ferguson, Ford, John Deere, David Brown, Case, International Harvester, Universal, Deutz, Leyland, Landini, Oliver, Fiat, Alice, Zetor, White, and a lot more. If you don't have internet, just call Mark at 250-395-0960. One click or one call, and the parts will be on their way. BZTractorParts.com. The 30th Annual Stony Plain Cowboy Gathering happens August 12th to 14th at Emmanuel Lutheran Church, Stony Plain, Alberta. Storytelling, music, and poetry with stars like Tom Cole.
Let me sing you a picture of an Alberta sky.
Doris Daly.
The porch light's on, a fire crackles bright, maybe Ian's singing at the Longview Hall.
Stuart McDougall.
As long as there's a memory of him, the sun ain't going down, sundown slim.
And so many more. For tickets and information, call 780-718-5379 and see StonyPlainCowboyGathering.com.
That's how it goes.
Okay, and if you'd like to win a pair of passes for the whole weekend at that gathering, all you have to do is come up with the right answer to this question and email it. All right, tell you where to email it after I give you the question. The famous Sons of the Pioneers were founded in 1933 by three musicians. One was Bob Nolan, a Canadian. Another one was Tim Spencer. And who was the third one? All right, email your answer to stonyplaincowboygathering@gmail.com. My friend Ivan Daines, legendary bronc rider himself, is a keen observer of life, and he's got a knack for writing songs about what's happening right now. I'm not sure if I'll be playing this song in 2032, but it sure is relevant right now, the first half of 2022.
2022 started out better than the last two did. Greatness, but also sadness in some lives that were lived. Jack Dane's 85 lived a life to the fullest he did. Rodeo cattle wife Audrey Duane, Brenda Lee, Joanne, and grandkids. Saddle bronc riding, rodeo hall of fame, many lifetime awards. Announced rodeos, an auctioneer, loved the family he adored. Young brothers Glenn, Ivan, Franklin, and Jack rode out of his one-gate chute. Then built Esty Bardane's rodeo ranch, now stands as a salute. Dave Shields loved bareback broncs, teaching, working stock right, all say. Wild horse racing champ, Calgary Douglas Lake, 66-year-old always. Naomi Judd, 76, depression took her before her Hall of Fame. Nashville's Winona, Ashley in country music, honor her name. Canadians lost a great hockey player and man of class all his own. 5 Stanley Cup championships, Montreal Canadiens, Guy Lafleur was known. National funeral across Canada led with tears and cheers for days. 70 years gave his life to all. Sinatra sang, I did it my way. He was part of Pinocchio's famous name, Ralph Old Baseball Auction Rodeo. Wife Del, Ryan, Blair, Lori, Kathy, Vicky, grandkids also. He's in the Hall of Fame, helped keep egg sales the same as the USA. Ralph Old passed at 91, Elvis sang, I did it my way. Ronnie Hawkins the Hawk, Arkansas to Canada, godfather of rock and roll. At 87, a great singer friend in the band, his life he told. At 67, Ray Liotta in the Field of Dreams, a great movie made. With Kevin Costner, this year's marshal of the great Calgary Stampede Parade. At 42, Shane Yellowbird, great native singing cowboy, is gone. Me and my pickup truck, family, friends, and fans love this and all the songs. Mickey Gilly, 86, Nashville, great urban cowboy sound, not wrong. New Mexico's Baxter Black, 77, great cowboy poet, so long. We'll miss the great cowboy Clayton Hines, there's sadness in the song.
Pro Rodeo stated that legendary stock contractor and rodeo producer Cotton Rosser, Marysville, California, passed June 22, 2022 at 93. He will be missed by everyone in rodeo.
Ah, well done, partner. Kind of sad, but Ivan brings such a uniqueness to his observations on the world, and I wouldn't be surprised if Ivan did some bronc riding practices at the Gottfriedson Ranch, where Gary's dad, Gus, ran that great string of bucking horses, and I know that Ian Tyson was down there doing some of that years and years ago. Now it's back to the conversation with the well-known teacher, orator, and award-winning author, Gary Gottfriedson. Yeah.
Did you guys, like with all your brothers and sisters, and all of you were in rodeo, did you guys ever pull any pranks on each other, or did you get any pranks pulled on you from your brothers, or was there any of that kind of stuff?
Ronnie was the worst one.
Oh, really?
Ronnie was a trickster. You know, my dad would say, you never, ever run the horses home after they've done a hard day's work. You walk them home. And even if they didn't work and you're just out there riding, you walk them home. Well, my brother Ronnie one day says, let's race home, you guys. Well, he was way older than the rest of us. And we thought, good, because you know when you're a kid, you love that excitement of, you know, the galloping horse. And away we go again, flying across the flats, Skidam Flats towards home. Ronnie pulls his rope out, right on a full gallop, start roping us.
Oh no!
Yeah.
Pulling you off your horses.
Pulling us off our horses, and the only way we could get away from him is we just lay right down on the saddle, right on the neck. And he, you know, the rope would just skim across our backs and stuff, but sometimes we'd drop the reins, you know, let go the reins, and the reins would bust, and we'd he was a trickster, that guy.
Oh man.
Yeah.
Well, Gary has an amazing background in education, philosophy, history, and more. And if you just search out Gary Gottfriedson, you'll find a lot of really interesting information. In fact, there's a great piece on Gary written by Trudy Fisk on the front page of cowboylife.com.
Next, it's a good song and the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. Coming up in the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight, a memory of the beloved rancher and poet Lloyd Dolan. Another good cowboy singer was riding the crest of popularity with a new CD, and that was about the time we lost him in 2008. Tony Reed was a good horseman and cowboy, and he wrote terrific songs. Here's one example, right back down the trail.
I told you that I loved you before I rode away. Chased those cows on up from Santa Fe. You told me that you loved me too. Now that I know what I have to do, I'm riding right back down the trail to you. I'm riding right back down the trail to you. Making sure my love for you stays true. Riding to the sunset, you can be sure, yes you can bet. I'm riding right back down the trail to you. Pulling drag for days and days, working hard for a cowboy wage. My saddle is worn, my jeans are faded too. Horse is tired, my rope is broke. Cash my check, it's in my poke. And I'm riding right back down the trail to you. As I top out on the trail and down the hill, the mockingbird is singing, my heart is fairly leaping, and I'm riding right back down the trail to you. Riding right back down the trail to you. Making sure my love for you stays true. Riding to the sunset, you can be sure, yes you can bet, I'm riding right back down the trail to you. Riding right back down the trail to you. Riding right back down the trail to you.
You know, long before cowboy poetry became well known, a few gifted cowboys were writing and reciting moving, funny, riveting poems, sometimes by lantern light, sometimes around the campfire. One of those was Lloyd Dolan, a rancher, cowboy, shrewd horse trader, and a warm and funny human being. I had him on this show as a guest, I guess it was probably 2 years or so before he died in 2004. Now, I always enjoyed visiting with him, as did anyone who knew him. This is Lloyd's grandson, Lloyd, in the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight.
Now, this poem was written in memory of my grandfather, Lloyd Patrick Dolan. He was a hero of mine, and I still miss him every day. It's called He Taught Me. Now, he taught me right from wrong. He taught me to listen to the words and not just the song. He taught me how to set a horse and how to fix a fence. He taught me to make the best out of any circumstance. He taught me to treat folks as I'd want to be treated. He taught me to turn the other cheek when things get a little heated. He taught me to do my best and to never shirk a task. He taught me to never quit. The quitters finish last. He taught me to respect my mom and my dad. He taught me that family is all that we have. Now he taught me to fix the tire on that old farm truck. And he taught me to never give up when you're down on your luck. He taught me to trail a deer and stay on the right track. He taught me it's better to shoot a dry doe. You can't eat a big rack. He taught me how to get home. If I should ever become lost, follow that old North Star and stay calm at all costs. And all the things he taught me, I still use them every day. But the one thing I use the most is when he taught me how to pray.
His hands are shaking and the breath he's taking is weak. He's lost in time, trapped in his mind, a tear rolling down his cheek. He can't understand, this wasn't the plan, but he's fought all he can fight. 80 years of blood, sweat, and tears, and it all ends tonight. With fear all around and death staring him down, oh, he just smiles back. He's the bravest soul I've ever known, my hero, my dad. He worked himself to death with 60-hour weeks and burned at both ends all his life. Now he's a man's man with barbed wire hands. He could look the devil square in the eye. A cowboy, an Air Force man, and everything to me. We love you, Dad. Rest in peace. Checking fence on those golden streets. Boy. He'd holler for the boys, put down them toys, and load up in a truck. 'Cause God our maker gave us 10,000 acres to ride, to check and have fun. He could shoot them down, tear down the town, and dance the night away. But he'd be up at dawn, have the coffee on, and work harder than he played. The angels have called, he didn't listen at all. Cancer and that couldn't stop a man too busy to die. He worked himself to death with 60-hour weeks and burned at both ends all his life. Now he's a man's man with barbed wire hands. He could look the devil square in the eye. A cowboy, an Air Force man, and everything to me. We love you, Dad. Rest in peace. Checking fence on these golden streets. He married the love of his life. He treated her right. Gave her a family. 60 years together, turning into forever. They'll last through eternity. As he drifts away, his eyes seem to say, I love, miss you all. The years pass his mind to another time with his love and the Tennessee waltz. He worked himself to death with 60-hour weeks and burned at both ends all his life. Now he's a man's man with barbed wire hands. He could look the devil square in the eye. A cowboy, Air Force man, and everything to me. We love you, Dad. Rest in peace. Checking fence on those golden streets. Yeah, we love you, Dad. Rest in peace. Checking fence on those golden streets.
That's Austin Waylart, kind of a young fella who was mentored by Baxter Black in his early career. Well, thank you so much for riding along, and I sure hope you can be right back here next week at the same time. And thanks, as always, to our great support crew, Mark and Kathy McMillan. Oh, yeah, lots of great reading in the latest issue of Canadian Cowboy Country Magazine. You can subscribe online at canadiancowboy.ca. And be sure to check out our YouTube channel, where you can see every program with video, and you can download the show as a podcast as well. The links are on our website, hugh-mclennan.com. Till next week, I am Hugh McLennan. Hope to see you down the trail somewhere real soon.